In this video, we're going to start the process of connecting the parts in the schematic. Remember, a board design is really a database. When we move a part over to the schematic, we're saying this part with this information from the library database is now part of our board design. In wiring the terminals together, we are creating graphically the netlist to tell the database how each terminal is connected and which terminals are associated with each net. In addition, remember our goal in creating a schematic is to make it as easy to read as possible. Along the way, there are going to be a lot of details that we're going to want to keep track of. I've listed some of them here. When we put a part down on the board from the integrated library, it should be associated with a footprint. This is going to be really important when we push it into the layout. And so periodically, it's worthwhile to check some of the footprints of the parts just to make sure that they're present. We can let Altium do a lot of the work in auto-numbering the reference designators. We're going to look at the use of net names in order to simplify a little bit of the routing and some of the special net names that we reserve for special nets like power and ground. It's always a challenge when we route the board to decide what nets do we want to have as physical wires that we see in the schematic, and what nets do we want to use labels for in order to establish connectivity. We'll look at a couple of those examples. In addition to making the schematic easy to read, one of the other goals in generating the schematic is to provide for us some association of parts that we want to pay attention to in the layout. Components that are associated with each other, like decoupling capacitors to an IC, should be placed in close proximity in the schematic just to make it easier to see that connectivity and to be thinking about how we're going to place those parts on the layout. Let's get started wiring up the schematic, and we'll take a look at some of these issues as we go. Here we are with the schematic as we left it in the previous video. If you had closed Altium and brought it up again, we would find that we have available in the Components tab the various integrated libraries, and usually the first one in the list is what appears. This is one of the default libraries, the miscellaneous library. If we pull down that selection menu, we see, oh, here is our integrated library that we want to use. We're going to click and highlight that. Remember, once you've activated the integrated library, that means that it is installed in Altium. Every time you bring up Altium, it's going to remember where that integrated library is as long as you don't move it. This library is global, and you have it available for all of your schematics that you want to use. And here are all those parts that we dealt with. Each one of these parts is really linked to this library. We've only moved over symbol information about each of the parts. In addition, each part has a footprint information, which is going to grab from that library when we need it, when we push the schematic over to the layout. And just to verify that, sometimes it's a good idea to take a look at a component and just make sure that, yep, we've got its footprint available. Let's grab this LED. We've highlighted it. And now we're going to look at the information in the library for this component. So it's been highlighted over here. Here's the general information about it. We've got the reference designator. We've got some comment here, which is related to the part number for this part. Here's more information. We scroll down and let's see. Oh, look, here is the footprint. That's great. And if we grab our 10X probe over here, oh, we see the footprint over here. And if we grab our switch over here, oh, there's the footprint. And so it's always a good habit every now and then to take a look at each of the parts and make sure that we have the footprint information. If we have a good integrated library that's stable and that was created well, then every symbol is going to have its footprint linked in that integrated library. These are the books, and each book has been compiled, published into chapters. First chapter is the symbol, second chapter is the footprint. Now if you notice, all of these parts, they have this red squiggly line. Generally a red squiggly line is not a good sign. It says something is missing. In this case, we haven't updated the reference designators. We can let Altium do that for us automatically. When we put a part down, or we select it over here and look at it, you notice the designator is D, that stands for diode, and the question mark. That means we haven't assigned a number for which individual part this particular diode is. We can let Altium do that for us, and that's called annotate. If we go to Tools and Annotate or Annotation, we're going to annotate the schematics, and it will automatically update those reference designators for us. We can do that anytime during the creation of the schematic. I like to do it after we have all the parts down, so we only do it once or maybe twice if we add another part. Doesn't really matter, but I just don't like seeing those red squiggly lines as I'm connecting things together. So let's annotate the schematic. And when we do that, we get, you know, a lot of complicated screens. Don't worry about any of this. What we're going to do is, these are the proposed changes. We're going to say update the changes list. It's going to do all those automatically. It says 21 changes were made. We say OK. And now we're not done yet. We've made the changes. We have to accept the changes. These are the engineering change orders, very official sounding term. We're going to accept those changes. We're going to create the engineering change orders to make those changes. We're going to check and validate. Yep, here all the changes are going to be. And look, it's going to automatically increment wherever we had a question mark to increase those numbers. So every part will have a unique number. We want to validate the changes. Oh, look, we got a little positive green check mark. That's a happy sign. That says, yep, it's correct, no errors. And now we have to execute the changes. And so we're going to type execute, and now it's done. And now we can close. So it's a very official process we go through. Got to make sure we click all of those buttons. We're done. Everything is done. We've accepted the changes. We're going to close this. And now when we come back, oh, look, every component has a unique reference designator that we're going to refer that component with. And when we push this schematic to the layout, each one of these parts and their associated footprint is going to be placed on the layout page on the circuit board with this unique reference designator name next to it. That's going to be critical when we do assembly of the board or when someone else does assembly of the board. Now we're ready to start the wiring. Let's wire up the components in the power conditioning section first. Here's how we're going to do it. You notice the toolbar at the top here. Each one of these has a number of options available to them. To look at all the options, we're going to click on one of them and right mouse click, and here are the different options for that particular icon. We can use this one as a wire, some other things, and a net label. We're going to keep it for wire on wire for now. Left mouse click, we select that icon for our cursor, and now we're ready to wire things up. We're going to zoom in on the connector over here first. You notice the pins for this connector. The pins have a very special part on them, that is the terminal. And you notice for this particular pin, tiny little dots on that end of that pin, that is the terminal. That is the only place on that pin that we can connect a wire. And when we get close enough, close as the snap grid, in this case 100 mils, when we get within 100 mils, we automatically snap the end of the wire to that terminal. That's why the grid size is so important. If we use a grid size of 100 mils and all the components have their pins with terminals on 100 mil centers as well, then we are guaranteed to make our wiring job so much easier. We're going to create a bus for the 5-volt rail, which is just a wire going across the power conditioning section. So we snap onto the terminal. We draw a wire, and we'll just pause it over here. We're going to click once. That's going to terminate the end of that wire at that place in space. Our icon still hasn't changed, so we need to escape out once and escape out another time. And now we've placed a wire there. We're going to add to this bus the three components they're going to attach to it. We've got the test point, we've got the filter capacitor, and we've got the LED. So we're going to first put the capacitor, we'll put it over here. We'll put our test point over here, and I'm going to highlight both of the LED and the resistor, and we're going to place them over here. And now it's a simple matter of connecting the terminals of each of the components to the wire. Now I could just drag the component and have its terminal touch the wire, but then I'm attaching that particular wire to the component. If I move the component around, it'll move the wire as well. And so I'm going to put a discrete wire between the terminal and the capacitor and the bus. And I'm going to wire all three of these objects as well. So we're going to grab left mouse click. Now I've got a wire object. I'm going to zoom in just to make it a little easier. We're going to wire up the capacitor. I'm going to wire up the LED. And I'm going to wire up the test point. In addition, I want to connect ground to the ends here. And ground is special. Ground is one of the power ports. And if we come over to the toolbar and we right mouse click where we see a little ground icon, these are all of the power ports. A port is a special net name that transcends schematic pages. So if we have a project that has multiple schematic pages on it, it's still one board, but we can't fit everything on one page. A port is how we make a connection from one schematic page to another schematic page. And ground is special. And whenever we have ground or some specific power rails, I want to use that power port in order to fully distinguish, oh, that's a special net. So we're going to first select ground. And now we're going to connect ground to each of the terminals. We'll have a ground, and a ground. And we're done. We can neaten this up a little bit because, you know, I like to have it a little bit neat. So I'm going to zoom out. And we can just move this up just a tad. So I select these guys. And there we go. So now we have everybody within that quadrant. Now, this is 5 volts coming out. You know, I'd really like to identify this as, yeah, this is the 5-volt rail. This is what's going to be coming out of this block. That's really the output, that 5-volt rail. And we have a special power port that we can use to do that. So we come to the PowerPoint, the power ports, right mouse click, and now here are our options. Hey, here's a 5-volt power port. I'm going to select that icon. My cursor has now changed, and I'm going to connect that power port label to the connection to that rail. So I click, and now it's in. And of course, escape to clear that out. You know, to neaten this up a little bit, I'd like to do two things. First is, you know, there's a dangling segment here. Yeah, I don't really need that. If I click once, that identifies the entire net. If I click a second time, that identifies just the segment of the wire to the nearest node. And now that I've identified that, now if I push the delete key, it's gone. Now it's cleaned up a little bit. I click anywhere to unhighlight that net. There's one last thing that we're going to do to clean up this section, and that is our test point. Yeah, it says test point 1. It's automatically numbered. It's a unique identifier. But you know, again, the second goal in a schematic is you want to make it easy to read. And so I'd really like to identify this test point as, oh yeah, that's going to be my 5-volt test point. And here's how we do that. I'm going to click to identify that part, and we come all the way over to the properties page of this part. This is no longer the database in the library. This is the database of the schematic. We have embedded a copy of this book into the schematic. It's now owned by the schematic, and here is access to the database in the schematic. We know that because this is the reference designator. This is the unique name for that part. Whereas if we were to find the part in the library, let's see, that's going to be test point here. This is the database entry in our integrated library for that test point. And see, it's a different designator. And so we've got to keep straight where those parts are. Once we've got, I'm going to push escape to clear that. Once we've got a part from the integrated library moved to the schematic, we are adding a copy of that component, of that book, into the schematic. So here's our part identified. Here's the reference designator. Yep, it says that's the unique part. And now under the comment field, it says, okay, 10x probe. Yeah, I know that. But what I really want to do is say, that's the test point for the 5-volt rail. So I'm going to change the comment for that specific part. And I'm going to say 5-volt. And now you notice there's a little eyeball here that's got a slash. That means it's not visible. If I click that eyeball, now it's visible. And look, now I have identified that test point in my schematic as the 5-volt rail. It will do nothing for the layout. It's solely to make it easier to read the schematic. And this is the process that we're going to do for all of the components in each of the sections. We're going to wire them up, and we're going to decide for each of the wires that we include, which ones do we want to have as a direct wire, and which ones do we want to have as a net label? And we'll talk about that in the next video.